Thank you so much, Helen. You notice she does that without a stitch of music in front of her, all from memory. Bless you. We've all been given a gift of song, and we're going to use that gift tonight to praise the Lord. I want to invite you to stand, please, and you can use either your hymnal or your program. Let's offer our voices to the Lord as we sing Emmanuel. Please stand.
Ooh, my baby,
Would you take your bulletin again, please, and we have a reading to be done responsively. Are you ready to celebrate the promised King?
We are ready. Our hearts are full of joy.
To whom has the King been born?
The King is born within and among us.
Then you must rejoice.
We do rejoice and are very thankful.
Amen. Russel is going to come now and read for us a poem of the season written by Helen.
A star shone so brightly the night of Jesus' birth. He came to save us, bringing peace, goodwill on earth. The angels in the heaven with their voices loudly sang, glory to God in the highest, how the heavens rang. The shepherds in the hillside wondered at the sight, all that their flocks in the middle of the night. Hurrying to the little town, to Bethlehem they went, following the star, knowing they were sent. Wise men in the east saw the star above, telling them of Jesus and God's wonderful love. They journeyed to the distant land to where Jesus lived, bowing down before him, their gifts they brought to give.
Testament reading this evening is from the prophet Jeremiah, and it sets in context the birth of Jesus. God made promises in the Old Testament that he kept in the New, and Jesus was born to a particular people, to a particular place, a particular time, and brought the good news to them first. But Jeremiah predicted this wonderful birth and the restoration and renewal of the people of God. Jeremiah 31, verse 7. Now this is what the Lord says. Sing with joy for Israel. Shout for the greatest of nations. Shout out with praise and joy. Save your people, O Lord, the remnant of Israel. For I will bring them from the north and from the distant corners of the earth. I will not forget the blind and the lame, the expectant mothers and those in labor. A great company will return. Tears of joy will stream down their faces, and I will lead them home with great care. They will walk beside quiet streams, and on smooth paths they will not stumble. For I am Israel's father, and Ephraim is my oldest child. Here's this wonderful picture of God the Father taking his children by the hand and leading them home again. Isn't that what Christmas is in part about? Being led by God the Father. We want to give you an opportunity again to express your praise in the carols of the season. Would you stand again, please, and sing, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
Sweet, the sweet.
Heard the shepherd's story were astonished, but Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them. Is Christmas just another day? Once in a while you hear some grinchy people say, "Ah, Christmas is just another day." You ever want to turn to them and say, "Do you have any idea how much time I've spent preparing for Christmas? Do you have any idea how much money? Do you have any idea how important it is?" Chances are they won't. But what is it that makes Christmas special? Is it the gifts? Because when we were young, let's be honest, that was pretty important. Now, if you do an internet search of worst Christmas presents ever, you'll have the difficult task of weeding out some really tragic fails in the gift-giving department. Thankfully, I've done that for you. And I've got three little amusing stories about some Christmas gifts that went awry. And I quote, "Once I received a clock with a gigantic moose on it. I hated the woodsy theme, and the worst part is every hour the moose makes a loud groan for 60 seconds. There's no way to shut it off. My mother-in-law bought it, and since she is at my house to watch my kids every day, I can't put it away. Every time the moose groans, she laughs and congratulates herself on getting the best Christmas gift ever. I've tried several times to break it without any luck. The worst gift I ever received," wrote another person, "was from my boyfriend. After being together for a year and a half, he got me a Red Baron pizza. I also got a stupid card and a bunch of peanut M&Ms. I don't even like peanut M&Ms. Although in that case, I can't really see what her gripe is about. I mean, pizza is the four basic food groups, right? And M&Ms are a dessert, so there's a full meal right there." One final one, a lady wrote, "One year when I was about 12, Granny gave me a piggy bank that she had made from a Clorox bottle." Now let's be honest out there, how many of you have made a piggy bank out of a Clorox bottle? That's old school stuff right there. Even had a pipe cleaner for the curly tail. "I have always been very crafty and enjoyed making things. I guess she thought I would like it because she made it. Well, I started to fill it with loose change. After all, it's a piggy bank, right? What completed the experience was when she asked for it back 6 months later. She wanted to use it as a display for her Sunday school class." So some of these stories may have you wondering and scratching your head thinking, what were they thinking in these choices of gifts? And sometimes thinking isn't really involved, is it? We just see something and react. Thankfully, Christmas is not based on the gifts that we give one another, not even on the gifts that the wise men gave the baby Jesus. Instead, Christmas, the greatest gift of all, is the foundation of our celebration. It is the gift of eternal life in Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul put it this way, Romans chapter 6, verse 23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus, our Lord." Friends, here in one sentence, Paul intensified the horror of sin and the glory of eternal life by putting them right next to each other. We perceive the value of God's gift in part by knowing the alternative. And the alternative to life is death on an eternal scale. Worse, death is unnecessary. God's gift of life is free. We can do nothing to earn it. We cannot make ourselves worthy of it. We have only to receive it. In this case, though, free is not the same as cheap. Eternal life is offered freely to all people because Jesus was born. He lived a human life and then surrendered that life on the cross to pay the wages of my sin and yours. Eternal life cost him more than an agonizing, humiliating death. He who had no sin became sin for us who are full of it. The only response to this gift that makes any sense at all is humble acceptance. By faith, we accept God's gift and live eternally. Now, I may have told you this story before, but our first Christmas together, I got Carrie a vacuum cleaner as a present. Now, don't be too quick to judge me. I went out and got the very best vacuum cleaner that I could afford for my beloved bride. And Jean at Sears assured me that she would love it. Not so much. Sadly, I did not learn from that first Christmas and have pretty frequently erred in guessing whether the Christmas at hand is either a sentimental one or a practical one. And if I don't guess that right, then the whole thing is off kilter. I hope no one's keeping score, but I suspect that my mistakes outnumber my hits. But here's a gift that really is always appropriate, and it really is one size fits all. God's offer of eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Here's what John wrote. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to be children of God. John 1:13. Now friends, in all of the talking, in all of the celebrating, in all that we do, it comes down to this. Life and love. Those are the two important things, aren't they? And we receive both of them in Jesus Christ. It's a gift that keeps on giving, blessing you and growing within you your whole life long. God bless you this Christmas. Now our special ministry will be Dawn coming to play for us. And she brought some others. Thank you. like to invite you for just a couple minutes here to share some of the joy of this evening, this season, and the peace that God gives with the people sitting around you. So turn to the person next to you and tell them how they can get off the naughty list. And then turn around, smile, and wave at one another, and say Merry Christmas, flash the peace sign, thumbs up, whatever works for you. Let's just greet one another in the peace of Christ.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to the best day.
Thank you.
Now you're in for a special treat as well. If you like the piano and you like the organ, you're going to love them both together.
Thank you.
Jesus' name, amen.